We'll get started. We have somebody who's very anxious and excited to be here, as I'm excited to have her here. So I know that folks will probably be coming in still, and that's okay. We have plenty of time for Victoria to present and time for her to answer questions. So let me first start out by introducing myself, and I apologize for this little teeny mic that's going to get clipped on her in a second, but it's easier for you all to be able to hear me. My name is Renee Zimmerman, and I'm the coordinator of CCAT. And in San Mateo County, we love our acronyms. So I'll just share with you that that stands for Children's Collaborative Action Team. And CCAT has actually, for the last 10 years or so, been serving in the capacity as the designated Child Abuse Prevention Council for San Mateo County. And each county in the state is required to have a Child Abuse Prevention Council. Some function as separate nonprofits, some function out of county offices, and some are collaborative, such as ours. And the Board of Supervisors has designated CCAT as such. And so part of our mission is to really raise awareness in the county around issues of child abuse prevention and intervention. And we put on one or two evening presentations a year that are free and open to the public on different topics. So we're very excited and proud this evening to be able to present to you what we feel is a very important topic and not always one of the funner ones. I have to admit, one of the funner ones that we had was this one on street drugs, and all up here were all these different drugs, and they had all the paraphernalia, and I had learned all these different things, and you know, it was very kind of interactive, and for folks that didn't know anything about it, found it to be very interesting. We've had ones on gang prevention, but this is a topic that's very, very important and one that we don't want to shy away from, and that's why we wanted to bring it to you tonight. We had listed on the flyer a co-presenter, Jane Smithson, and she's on medical leave. And so I'm very proud and honored to be able to introduce briefly by name, and then I'll have her give a better introduction than I will, the Honorable Patricia Brzee. Patricia will be kind of co-presenting and with Victoria tonight, asking questions in kind of an interview style. So without further ado, I think I'll welcome her up, and please welcome her tonight. Thank you.
Telling us her story as to how she reached this point. So it is a great honor to be able to introduce Victoria Balfour. When she first called me 2.5 years ago.
Yes, it was in December 2007.
Who's counting? This is a reporter. And it was kind of one of those phone calls where you say, oh, God, I just don't want to talk to you. About an hour later, we found her on the phone, and I was totally committed to do all I could to help her. She's that good. And so with that, I'm going to ask Victoria to put on the microphone. So you can do this. And we're going to, first I'm just going to get a Kleenex here. And I'm going to sit here, and the way the evening is going to go, I used to be a chef, so. No, I know nothing about it. Is this working? Is it working?
No.
Not really.
No.
And it'll hold it. We have to hold it to you now.
No.
You can hear me though, right?
Yeah, I'll talk loud, and I'll try and tell me if I talk too fast.
We're just going to ask, we have a Spanish, simultaneous Spanish translator with the headset. So would that, is there anybody that that would help make it more comfortable? Spanish and with the headset. Perfect. She's just arriving.
Just a little bit more about Victoria. This is not the only story she's reported in her long career. She's been an investigative journalist for over 30 years, and her articles have appeared in the New York Times and in the New Yorker.
Washington Post.
Glamour. I know Glamour. And in 2007, Victoria was named a Rape Advocate of the Year by the Awareness Center, a group for survivors of sex abuse based in Baltimore, Maryland. And they honored her for her dedication and determination in exposing this case and offering hope to all survivors. So, Victoria Balfour. Go. I'm going to ask your first question. The way we'll do this is I will pose some questions as we move along. But I really want Victoria to tell her own story. They won't have an opportunity for dialogue. So, Victoria, I know you live in New York. Had you ever even heard of San Mateo County?
No, I had never heard of San Mateo County. And I'll tell you how this got started. I stumbled into the case of Dr. Ayres through a business acquaintance who was a cartoonist who lived in Ohio. And I'd never actually even met him in person. And one day in May 2002, he called me and said he had a friend named Steve who lived in Brooklyn who had lost his job in photo research after September 11th. And Steve was very depressed and not doing well, but he's very bright and a good writer. And would I talk to Steve about getting into journalism? I said, well, you know, I'm doing silly stuff for women's magazines, and I don't think he'd be very interested in that. So somehow the cartoonist talked me into talking to Steve. A few days later, Steve called me. He was very bright and personable and engaging. He was very depressed. It was 9 months after September 11th, and he was still struggling with the impact in his life. Like, a lot of people were very upset, obviously, but most people just didn't talk about the after effects anymore. But Steve was really hitting home. Anyway, he asked me what kind of stories I'd written as a journalist. And off the top of my head, I said that I'd written a story for Vogue about my grandmother. And I said to him, my parents were furious with that story. And he said, why? This is all on the telephone. And I said, because I had one line in it about being molested as a child. And he said, who molested you? And I said, my older brother. And that's when Steve, by no 10 minutes on the phone, said, oh, I was molested by a child psychiatrist named Dr. William Ayres in San Mateo. And that's the first I'd never heard of San Mateo.